Many of you perhaps who have been in any way involved in the feminist movement, in minority empowerment, are familiar with this phrase. People need to be empowered, okay? And it's ironic to put it that way because you can't empower somebody directly, you know, because if you're doing it, then they're not getting that sense of power. And that's what empowerment is that perhaps providing an open space, okay, taking hands off the situation, and providing competency experiences for a person. And I think this is especially relevant for parents who want to build a sense of self-esteem, self-efficacy, create a can-do attitude in their children, that parents need to provide experiences where the child can do something and be successful at it. So what does that require? That you open up the space in your life or your child's life for small experiences that you have a good idea that they're gonna do well at, so they can build upon that. And they can say, hey, yeah, I can do that. Maybe I can do this a little bit more. That they see you doing something. You know, you are like your children. They wanna be like you. They pay attention to you. You're important. And so you can use that modeling with the competency experiences to provide growth of self-efficacy. Okay? The individual has to build a strong self-belief. And what that's based upon is past experiences. So give them those experiences. Make sure that they have the experiences in their life where they try stuff and they succeed at it. Small things. Okay. There's one phrase from the Star Wars series, the first three, I haven't watched any of the other ones, where Yoda says, do or do not do, there is no trying, okay? And what that emphasizes is do the behavior, just do it, although I don't like that one very much. And as a parent, you want to make sure that that behavior is going to result in a successful outcome. And so make it small, make it based on their successes in the past. Okay. There's been lots of research on self-efficacy. It has been useful in helping people to stop substance abuse problems. If they have self-efficacy about their ability to quit, they are much more likely to actually quit than those who are low in self-efficacy on their ability to quit. So these same things that raise self-efficacy can be specifically applied to a drug and alcohol rehab program and have been found, through research, have been found to be highly effective. So increasing self-efficacy helps people do better in achieving their goals, whatever they are. Social goals, academic goals, personal goals, professional goals, all kinds of goals. Having goals is important too. You have to define the behavior you're trying to achieve so that once you achieve it, you know that you've achieved it. Okay? So that's self-efficacy. Our next theorist is Julian Rotter. And Julian Rotter titled his theory, and you can see that on your handout there, he titled his theory Cognitive Social Learning Theory. And so what Julian Rotter was trying to do was move even more away from that radical behaviorist. He found them incredibly lacking and wanted to say, you know, there's got to be room for cognitions in here. And so we are getting further and further away from the behaviorists, but we still have their roots. We still, as you can see from the title, that what we are is largely a result of learning. Now here, and I meant to mention this before when we were talking about Bandura, we are talking about people that are still alive. Albert Bandura is in his early 80s, and he is still active, not as active, but he's still active in the professional world. Julian Rotter is 92, and the last individual we're going to talk about is Walter Mischel, and he is 78. So they are around. What Julian Rotter was trying to do was include cognitions. And so he too has assumptions about people and humanity in general and what they're made up of. Assumption number one, people give environments meaning. Okay? Environments in and of themselves don't have meaning. Okay? If an environment came with meaning, then everybody would view that environment the same way. Okay? Let me take a little poll here. How many of you love sitting in the classroom? 6 of you, okay? How many of you are just bored silly by classrooms? Oh, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, so if the classroom itself had the meaning, all of you would be experiencing it the same way. Either all of you would be bored or all of you would love it. So the meaning is in the person, not in the environments, not in other people, okay? And that's a real important assumption. You might think, is she going to repeat it again? Why? Because it's really important for a cognitive theory. Meaning is housed in the person. The person gives the meaning to events, to environments, to other people. Okay? Events, people, and environments do not have inherent meaning. Okay? I've said it about 5 times, so it must be incredibly important. It is. Okay? So, our reactions to environments, to physical environments, to people, to events, our reactions are based on the meanings we give them. And that's the second part of this really important cognitive assumption. Meanings are housed in people, and our reactions to the events, to the people, to the environments are based on our meanings, okay? So, this is the second assumption, okay? The second assumption is, since personality is learned, it can always change because you can always learn something new, unlearn something, learn it differently. So there's a lot of room for growth and change in this theory. If we go back to our criteria, is there any explanation for how personality changes? Yeah, you can learn a new way of thinking about things, okay? And that's gonna change everything else. And so these are real important assumptions here. While there is consistency in personality, it is consistent because our learning is consistent, and we tend to seek out environments that maintain that consistency. So we're going to stay in environments that reinforce us for things we've already learned, thus making us stay the same. When we go into different environments that no longer reinforce us for that, we change, okay? I know it makes it sound simple. It's not, but it's simply understood. And so it helps us with a very simple approach to change and to helping people, okay? According to Rotter, we do things, we engage in behaviors because they get us closer to our goals. That's the primary motive for humans. We do things because they get us closer to our goals. That's Rotter's notion of motivation. Not because it reduces pleasure, there's a Freudian slip. Not because it reduces tension or because it's pleasure giving, but because it achieves our goals. Now, maybe one of our goals in a particular environment is pleasure, but it might not be in another instance. Okay, so he leaves room for a lot of different ideas that can motivate us. A final assumption about humanity that Rotter makes, it's important to know to understand where he's coming from, is that people can anticipate events. We can say, this is coming up, and so we can plan our behavior that's going to help us achieve what we want to achieve in that event. Okay, so we are forward thinking. We are thinking about the present, we're certainly thinking about the past, but we're also thinking about the future, and so we're forward thinking.